already studied. Now let me share my PPT with you students. Okay, science part 1, chapter 5, heat, in which we are going to learn about latent heat. What is mean by latent heat? Now let in this topic we will first learn a small activity. Okay, based on that we will study what is latent heat. Okay, this activity will not come in board paper, but based on this activity you can define what is latent heat of vaporization, what is latent heat of fusion. So I will just explain you what, how the experimental setup will be. You have to take few pieces of ice in a glass beaker. You can see here glass beaker. Okay, okay, so you can use, you can take ice and insert the bulb of the thermometer in the ice, okay, and measure its temperature, and then put the beaker on a stand and heat the ice using a beaker, sorry, burner. Okay, when you will burn that beaker, you will find that ice starts melting, and you have to record the temperature using the thermometer after every minute. Okay, keep on recording, and as the ice is heated it starts melting. So stir the mixture of ice and water. Okay, and continue heating even after the ice starts melting. Then you have to draw a graph of temperature versus time, which is shown in page number 63 of your textbook. There is a graph over there. Okay, so now from this activity what you learned is that you will observe that the temperature of mixture remains 0 degrees Celsius till the ice melts completely. Yes or no? The temperature will be constant, 0 degree, because it is ice. Till the ice starts melting it will be 0 degrees Celsius, but afterwards when you will keep on continuously heating, what will happen to all the ice? It gets converted into water. The temperature of water will rise and reach till how much degree temperature maximum? What is the rise in temperature? It will be 100 degrees Celsius. Okay, so at this temperature what happens? Water will start converting into steam, right? From solid to liquid state and then liquid to gaseous state. Now the temperature of water remains constant at 100 degrees Celsius till all the water gets converted into steam. Okay, so in this graph you will find that line AB represents what? Conversion of ice into water at constant temperature. When ice is heated, what happens? It will melt at 0 degrees Celsius and gets converted into water at this constant temperature. So the, what the ice is doing, ice is actually absorbing which energy, students? Can you put in the chat box? Ice is absorbing which energy here? Yes, Abhishek, you can put the answer in the chat box. Heat energy. Very good, Kushi, Hiral. Okay, so heat energy is absorbed by the ice during this transition, and the energy is absorbed and it continues till the ice converts into water. Till all the ice gets converted into water, this absorption of heat will continue and the temperature will remain constant during this transition. Transition means what? Change of state of substances from solid to liquid and then from liquid to gas. Okay, so this conversion or this constant temperature at which the ice gets converted into water, what we call this process as melting point of ice. Note it down, students. What is meant by melting point of ice? Okay, because the ice melts and gets converted to water at this point, right? So during this transition of solid phase to liquid phase, what happens? Object is absorbing heat energy, as you all told me now. What the ice is absorbing? Ice is absorbing heat energy, right? So what happens? The temperature will not increase that time, but this heat energy is used for what? Weakening of the bones, right? Sanskriti, correct? Weakening of the bones. Now where the bones will weak? Between the two atoms of the mole, or the between the molecules in the solid state. You know solids are made up of molecules. Okay, so there is a bone covalent and bones form. Okay, that bone will break, and what will happen? The solid state will get converted to liquid state. Okay, and the heat absorbed at this temperature during the transformation of solid state to liquid state, that is called as latent heat of fusion. Note it down, students, what is meant by latent heat of fusion. Okay, so definition is also given there. The amount of heat energy absorbed at constant temperature by unit mass of a solid to convert into liquid phase is called as latent heat, specific latent heat of fusion. Understood? So whenever specific latent heat of fusion comes, what happens? Solid gets converted to liquid state. Now what happens once it gets converted to liquid? Again, once all the ice is transformed to water, the temperature of water starts rising. Now the temperature keeps on rising. Okay, it increases up to 100 degrees Celsius. Maximum up to 100 degrees Celsius. Correct? Now you can see in the graph line BC. Okay, what it represents? Rise in temperature of water from 0 to 100 degrees Celsius. Correct? So therefore, thereafter what happens? Heat energy which is supplied to water, its temperature does not rise. Even if you supply heat energy, the temperature will not rise. The heat energy will be absorbed by water at this temperature. And what it is used? It is used to break the bonds between the molecules of liquid. Okay, there are bonds between molecules of liquid also. So that bones will break. Once the bones breaks, what happens to that liquid phase? It gets converted to vapor. Very good, Sanskriti, answering me correctly. So the liquid state will get converted to gaseous state. Correct? Now the constant temperature at which the liquid gets converted to gaseous, that temperature is nothing but what we can say boiling point. Liquid boils, no? So what happens, what we can say, it is a boiling point of the liquid. Okay, so underline that. What is meant by boiling point of a liquid? So the heat energy absorbed at that constant temperature during transformation of liquid into gaseous. Okay, so that temperature is called as latent heat of vaporization. You might have seen how the vapors come when the liquid boils. It gets converted to steam. Yes. So what we can say, it is latent heat of vaporization. So I explained to you about latent heat of fusion, where solid gets converted to liquid, and latent heat of vaporization, where liquid gets converted to gas. I hope everyone understood what do you mean by latent heat of fusion and vaporization. Okay. Fine, students. Okay, fine. So at the end, we will have an evaluation session where you have to answer me all this. I will be asking few questions related to this topic, right? Okay, fine. Okay, now students, let us move to the next topic. I will share my screen with you. Okay, here it is defined what is the specific latent heat, the amount of heat energy absorbed at constant temperature by unit mass of a solid to convert into liquid phase is called specific latent heat of fusion. Okay, now next we are going to the topic called regelation. What do you mean by regelation? This is a new topic for you, students. So you might have seen the preparation of ice balls, how ice balls are prepared. Okay, so many of you might have done this. Yes. So first, what an ice slab is shredded, and then the shredded ice is pressurized around the tip of a stick to prepare the ice ball. Okay, shredded means what? Powder form of ice. Okay, so how does this shredded ice converted back into a ball, ice ball? Okay, so if two small pieces of ice are taken and pressed against each other for a while, what will happen? They will stick to each other. Okay, do you know why this happens? So there is a short activity for you, students. You can see on the in the PPT what you have to do. Put a slab of ice on a stand as shown in the figure. Okay, this is a slab of ice. Okay, that you have to put in the on a table. Okay, hang two equal weights to the two ends of a metal wire and put the wire on the slab as shown in the figure. What do you observe? It is observed that the wire gradually penetrates the ice slab. What you will find that the wire is penetrating. Penetrating means what? It will move deep inside the ice slab, right? After some time, the wire comes out of the lower surface of the ice slab, right? So when it will penetrate, where it goes, it moves slowly down. You will see, find that the wire is coming out from the lower surface of this ice slab. However, the ice slab does not break. The phenomenon in which the ice converts to liquid due to applied pressure and then reconverts to ice once the pressure is removed is called rigelation. Note down, students, what is the definition of rigelation? Rigelation is a phenomenon in which ice gets converted to liquid. When you will apply pressure, what happens? It gets converted to liquid. And then what happens? It reconverts to back to ice. That means what? Solid to liquid state and then liquid back to solid state by application of pressure. And when you will remove the pressure, okay, it gets reconverts to ice. So that process is called as rigelation. I hope everyone understood what is meant by rigelation, students. Okay, fine. So rigelation was a new term for you, students. Okay, now here what happens actually when the wire penetrates, okay, so the ice, the melting point of ice becomes very low, okay, lower than 0 degrees Celsius due to pressure. Okay, so it becomes very low, and this means that at 0 degrees Celsius, what happens to the ice? It gets converted to water. Okay, it gets converted to water as soon as the pressure is removed. When you will remove the pressure, okay, at that time what happens to the melting point? It gets restored to 0 degrees Celsius. Melting point will get restored to 0 degrees Celsius, and you know at 0 degrees Celsius means water gets converted to what? Ice. Very good, Sanskriti. Okay, even others are also answering. Angela, good. So this process by which we can get the ice back, right? Conversion of solid to liquid and liquid back to ice, okay, by removal of pressure. This process is called as rigelation. Okay, so I hope everyone understood what is rigelation. Yes, okay, fine. Now let me share my PPT with you for the next topic. Okay, now you can see here one apparatus. Okay, this is nothing but Hope's apparatus. Okay, Hope's apparatus. For what we are using this Hope's apparatus, that you have to learn. Before that, I will explain you a short term regarding anomalous behavior of water. Then we'll go to the Hope's apparatus. Fine. What is this anomalous behavior of water? Suppose if water is heated. Okay, water is heated from 0 degree to 4 degree Celsius, right? So that time what happens? It will contract instead of expanding. Actually water should contract, but what it happens, actually it should expand, but what happens to that water? It will contract at 4 degree Celsius. What happens to the volume? Volume is minimum. Okay, volume is minimum. So if water is heated further, then it will be expand. Okay, so that is, its volume will increase. Expand means what? Volume increases. So this abnormal behavior of water in the temperature range from 0 degree to 4 degree Celsius, what we call this as anomalous behavior of water. Between 0 and 4 degree Celsius, water will behave abnormally. So that process is called as anomalous behavior. Okay, and what happens to the density of water? Density of water will be maximum at 4 degree Celsius. And why I am showing you Hope's apparatus? Because we are using this apparatus to study the anomalous behavior of water. Okay, so we can study the anomalous behavior of water by using the Hope's apparatus. Okay, now you can see in the textbook there is a graph shown over there. Yes, students. Okay, so in that graph, what is shown? The anomalous behavior of water we can study with the help of Hope's apparatus. So in Hope's apparatus, there is a flat bowl. Okay, the flat bowl is attached to a cylindrical container, right? And there is also provision to attach thermometers above. Okay, I have shown you the diagram also just now. Okay, so that why thermometers? To measure the temperature, right? So that time temperature, and below you can measure the temperature, above also and below also. So above means it will be T2 and below means it will be T1. Okay, and there is a flat bowl on the cylindrical container. Okay, so water is filled in the cylindrical container and a mixture of ice and salt. What you have to take? Freezing mixture. What do you mean by freezing mixture? You have to add salt to the ice. That is called as salt plus ice gives freezing mixture. Okay, so that is put in that flat bowl. You can see in the flat bowl. You can observe the diagram even in your textbook, page number 65. They're given the graph as well as the diagram. Okay, so during that, the study of this anomalous behavior of water using Hope's apparatus, what happens to temperature? I told you T1 and T2. The temperature you have to record after every 30 seconds. You have to record both the temperatures. Okay, the temperature will be plotted on a graph. You know how to plot the graph, right? So y-axis on the temperature, all the temperatures you have to note down in the y-axis, and time taken in minutes, that will be plotted on the x-axis. Okay, so graph is already drawn over there. You can see. Okay, voice is breaking, students. One second, let me check. No. Okay, some are saying no, some are saying yes. Sangeeta teacher.
Hello.
Yes, teacher. You have to measure both the temperature, T1 and T2. Okay, T1 of water is about lower part of the cylinder decreases fast, while T2 of water is the upper part of the cylinder, which decreases comparatively slowly. Okay, so that is also shown in the diagram. T1 and T2 is shown over there. Okay, T1 is 4 degrees Celsius, T2 is 0 degrees Celsius. However, once the T1, that is of the lower part, reaches 4 degrees Celsius, what happens? It remains stable at that temperature, and T2 will decrease slowly to 4 degrees Celsius. Okay, from 0 degree, it will decrease to 4 degrees Celsius. So thereafter, what happens? T2 starts changing rapidly, and it records 0 degrees Celsius at first, and after that, lower thermometer T1 records 0 degrees Celsius. Okay, so this point of intersection of these two curves shows what? The temperature of maximum density. So that time it is called as maximum denser. Okay, so how can we explain these by this observation? Initially, what happens? The temperature of water in the middle of the cylinder, that will lower due to freezing mixture of in the outer ball. In the outer ball, you have kept ice plus salt. Okay, that ice plus salt will decrease the temperature of water. Since the temperature of water will decrease, what happens? Automatically, what happens to the volume? Volume and volume will decrease and density will increase. Okay, so water with high density moves downwards, right? And therefore, what happens to the lower thermometer T1? It will show rapid fall in temperature. That means what? Temperature falls down rapidly, quickly, very fast. Okay, so and this continues till the temperature of water becomes equal to 4 degrees Celsius. So from 0, it will go to 4 degrees Celsius. Okay, so when the temperature of water starts decreasing below 4 degrees Celsius, what you will find that the volume increases suddenly. Okay, volume will increase and density will decrease, right? So it therefore moves in the upward direction. So when volume increases, what happens? It will move in the upward direction. Okay, so the temperature of water in upper part is what? T2. Okay, so therefore it will decrease to 0 degrees Celsius. So the temperature of water in the lower part will be T1. However, it will remain 4 degrees Celsius for some time, and then it will decrease slowly to 0 degrees Celsius. So in this way, that means what? Water is behaving abnormally. Water is behaving abnormally between 0 and 4 degrees Celsius. And what we call this process today, what is it called as? Anomalous behavior of water. And this little bit portion you have already done in 9th standard, I remember. Anomalous behavior of water was there for you. The same topic again, it is repeated here. So no doubt should be there. Okay, you can read the textbook. Okay, now what all things, now you might have seen aquatic plants and animals. They can survive even in very high, at high temperature. If the temperature is below 0 degrees Celsius also, they will survive. They will not die. Okay, because of this anomalous behavior of water. Even in cold regions, sometimes the pipes in winter season, the pipes for water supply, they will break and even rocks crack. So all this shows what anomalous behavior of water. These are some of the application of anomalous behavior of water. So I hope you understood what is anomalous behavior of water. Okay. Now next, moving to next topic, that is dew point and humidity. Let me share my screen with you, students. Okay, this is a picture which shows anomalous behavior of water, where fishes survive even in cold temperature. Okay, fishes can live because inside the water is from the top there is a layer of ice, right? Now next, I've shown you one this topic. This will not come. Introduction to scientists is not there for you. So let us move to the next specific heat capacity first. Okay, dew point and humidity we will do later. Okay, specific heat capacity. Now this can be explained by as again small activity. What is mean by specific heat capacity? What you have to do, you have to take a tray with thick layer of wax. Okay, solid spheres you have to take. First one is of iron. Here in the diagram you can see iron. Okay, this first one is what? It is iron, right? Next, second metal is copper, and the third one is lead, right? So in this way, they all should be of equal mass, right? Equal weight. Solid spheres of iron, lead and copper should be of equal mass. You should keep a burner or spirit lamp. You should take a large beaker. All these things should be there for the activity. Now take these three spheres of iron, copper and lead of equal mass. Okay, as shown the PPT, you can take the three spheres of iron, copper and lead of equal mass, and put all the three spheres in boiling water in the beaker for some time, right? So take the three spheres out of the water. All the spheres will be at temperature 100 degrees Celsius. Put them immediately on the thick slab of wax. Note the depth that each of the spheres goes into the wax. Okay, so that is your activity. You have to check what is the how the wax melts and which metal is going inside, right? So that is the experiment, right? I hope everyone has seen the PPT. Yes, so in that I have shown you the diagram which is already given in your textbook, page number 68, right? Now here, what happens? A sphere which absorbs more heat from the water will give more heat to the wax, right? All the three spheres are made up of different materials, so they are having different specific heat capacity. So more the wax will melt, will thus melt, and the sphere will go deeper in the wax. So it can be observed that the iron sphere will go deepest into the wax. Can you tell me why iron sphere will go deepest into the wax, Aditya? Yes, Aditya Bale Rao, give the answer. Why iron sphere will go deepest inside? Yes, Sanskriti, answer is correct. Very good. Okay, iron sphere is having maximum absorption of heat. Very good, Riya. Very good, Aditya. It will absorb more heat. Okay, iron is a metal and iron absorbs the maximum heat, right? Lead sphere goes the least, whereas lead is not going deep inside the wax. Okay, why? Because lead is not going, because of less absorption of heat. Very good, Sanskriti. So lead sphere goes the least and copper sphere goes to intermediate depth. In the diagram you can see copper is neither going deep nor going very least, so it is in the intermediate stage, right? So this shows that for equal rise in temperature, the three spheres have absorbed different amounts of heat. So different amounts of heat have been absorbed by different materials or spheres, different metals. Okay, the capacity of iron is different, copper is different, whereas lead is different. So this means that the property which determines the amount of heat absorbed by a sphere in different is different for the three spheres. So and this property is called as specific heat capacity. So So I hope you understood what do you mean by specific heat of heat capacity, right? Now, how you can define it? The definition should be as given in the textbook. How you will write the definition? The amount of heat energy required to raise the temperature of a unit mass of an object by 1 degree Celsius is called the specific heat of that object. Okay, I repeat the definition once again. How you can define the specific heat of the object? The amount of heat energy required to raise the temperature of a unit mass of an object by 1 degree Celsius. Okay, so that is called as specific heat of that substance. I hope everyone understood what is specific heat of a substance, right? Now, what is a unit? How you can, the specific heat is denoted by a letter. Anybody knows what is the alphabet used to denote it? Very good, Riya Tiwari, Neeraj, very good, Kushi, all are giving the answers in the chat box. Angela, it is not S, Angela. Angela, your answer is wrong. It is small letter C. Very good, Hiral, Raj Ayre. Okay, all are given. Many are giving the answers. So remember this small letter C. What it is used for? This alphabet is used for specific heat capacity. Okay. And what is the unit used for specific heat capacity? Specific heat of a substance. Okay. What is the, yes, joules per calorie. Very good, Kushi. Joules per degree Celsius, kilogram. And in CGS system, what you can say? Calories per gram degree Celsius. Okay. Right. So in this way, you can mention the units also. Suppose if the specific heat of object is C and the mass is M and temperature is T, and difference in temperature is delta T. Okay. So what you can say, how much heat energy is absorbed by that object? M into C into delta T. Okay, mass into specific heat capacity into difference in temperature. Okay, this way the formula comes, right? So in the same way, if the specific heat of an object is C, the mass of the object is M, and if temperature decreased is delta T degree Celsius, heat energy lost is also same. So heat energy absorbed is equal to the heat energy lost, right? So it will be again M into C into delta. So whatever the heat energy absorbed is lost also, right? So that is called as specific heat capacity. Now let us move to the PPT, students. Now heat exchange. How the heat is exchanged, right? Between a hot object and a cold object. Okay, so a box of heat resistant material you have to take, as shown in the diagram. It is a box of heat resistant material. It means what? Heat is resisted inside this box. Okay, so if we are heating an object, heat is exchanged between the hot object and a cold object. You're keeping some cold object near a hot object. What will happen? The hot object will transfer its heat to the cold object. The temperature of the cold object will slowly rise. It will increase. Why it increases? Because it absorbs the heat energy. Okay. And the temperature of hot object will decrease. Why it decreases? Because it is losing the energy. So in this way, what happens? There is change in temperature. It will continue. Okay. Keep on continuing till the temperature of both the object attains the same value. So in this process, what happens? The cold object gains the heat energy and hot object is losing the heat energy. Okay. So if the system of both the object is isolated from the environment by keeping it inside a heat resistant box, means what? That the energy exchange takes place between two objects only. There is no energy can flow from inside this box. Okay. You can heat resistant box means what? Heat energy is not flowing outside this box. So in this situation, I will get a following principle. Okay. Now, what is that principle? Okay, students. Okay. Now, let me explain you. You can say that heat energy lost by the hot object. okay, is equal to heat energy gained by the cold object. Whatever energy is lost, that is gained. Okay, who is gaining that? Cold object. Hot object is losing the heat energy, and cold object is gaining the heat energy. Okay, so this is called as principle of heat exchange. So note down, student, what do you mean by principle of heat exchange? Okay, so in this process, heat energy is lost by the hot object, and that will be equal to the heat energy gained by the cold object. Okay, so I hope you all understood what is exchange of heat energy between two systems. Okay, understood. Thank you, Tejal, Neha, okay, Kushi, etc., all of you. Okay, now next, moving to the topic, that is next topic. Okay, actually I'm okay, there is no need of PPT, students. Okay, covered maximum topics from the PPT. Now some of the topic which is left, that I will complete it. Okay, then we will go for evaluations, and your doubts also will be cleared there, right? Okay, now let us see what is mean by dew point and humidity. Okay, what do you mean by dew point and humidity? That topic is left. Let me start that. Okay, now suppose if the temperature of unsaturated air is decreased, okay, a temperature is reached at which the air will become saturated with water vapor, and that temperature, okay, to measure the temperature, and that temperature is called as dew point temperature, right? So if the temperature of unsaturated air, okay, that you are taking unsaturated air, and the temperature is decreased, temperature is reached at which the air will become saturated with water vapor, okay, so that temperature is called as dew point. So about 71%, okay, of Earth's surface is covered with water. You all know that. Okay, so what happens, there is continuous constant evaporation of water. Water vapor is always present in the atmosphere. So the amount of water vapor in the atmosphere will help us to understand the state of daily weather, how much the the temperature is, what is the state of the weather. Okay, what is helping us, that water vapor, how much the water vapor is present in the air. Okay, it will make the atmosphere moist, humid, etc. So the moisture in the air or in the atmosphere, that is called as humidity. How much moisture is present in the air, that is called as what? Humidity, right? Now for a given volume of air at a specific temperature, there is a limit on how much water vapor the air can contain, right? There is a limit, okay? Beyond that, it will not go, right? So if the amount exceeds this limit, what happens? Excess vapor will get converted into water droplets, right? And that what? When the air contains maximum water droplets, water vapor, okay? So that is said to be saturated with vapor at that temperature. You might be thinking, what do you mean by saturated? Okay, so if excess water vapor is present in the air, what you can say? The air has become saturated. Okay, saturated with what? Vapor. Okay, at that temperature it is saturated. So amount of vapor needed to saturate the air depends on temperature of the air. If the air temperature is low, it will need less vapor to saturate the air. Okay, for example, if the temperature of air is, suppose, 40 degrees Celsius, okay, it can contain 49 grams of water vapor per kilogram of dry air without condensation. So just for example, they given this. If the amount of vapor exceeds this limit, what happens? The additional vapor will condense. Okay, if the temperature of air is 20 degrees Celsius, it can contain only 14.7 grams of water vapor per kilogram of dry air without condensing. So if the vapor contained in air is less than the maximum limit, then the air is said to be saturated. So that is the meaning of saturation. Okay. So here you will get a formula how to find the percentage of relative humidity. Okay. Suppose unsaturated air at particular temperature is taken and its temperature is decreased. What happens? The temperature is decreased and the temperature will reach at which the air becomes saturated with vapor. And this temperature, what we call it as dew point temperature, right? What is called dew point temperature? The temperature will decrease to a temperature of the air becomes saturated with vapor. And this temperature is called as dew point temperature. Okay. So I hope you understood what is dew point temperature here. And the vapor content in the air will be measured by a physical quantity. And that physical quantity is called as absolute humidity. As I told you, what is absolute humidity? Okay. So the mass of the vapor present in unit volume of air is called as absolute humidity. How much vapor is present? How much mass of the vapor is present in the air? That is called as absolute humidity. Right. So generally absolute humidity, how we can measure? We can measure it in kilogram per meter cube. Yes, Riya and Sanskriti both are answering me. Good. Okay. So we can measure it in kilogram per meter cube, right? So the feeling of humid or dry nature of air not only depends on the amount of vapor in the air, but it also depends on how close that amount is for making the air saturated with vapor. So it means that it depends on temperature of the air also. Okay. So what is the temperature of air in for the, and that also depends. It depends on that, how much temperature the air is, right? So the ratio of actual mass of vapor content in the air for a given volume and temperature to that required to make the air saturated with vapor at that temperature is called the relative humidity. Note down, students, what do you mean by relative humidity? Okay. So in this way, you can note down the definitions and formulas of whatever is given and learn it, right? So you can write down percentage relative humidity is equal to actual mass of water vapor content in the air in a given volume divided by mass of the vapor needed to make the air saturated in that volume into 100. Okay, so I hope you all noted down the formula for finding the percentage relative humidity. Okay, students. So percentage relative humidity you can find out by using this. So the relative humidity at the dew point is 100%. If the relative humidity is more than 60%, what we feel that air is very humid. Okay, if the relative humidity is less than 60%, what we will feel? We can say the air is dry, right? So in this way, so during winter season, you may have observed there's a white trail at the back of a flying plane in a clear sky. Okay. As the plane flies, what happens? The vapor released by the aeroplane engine condenses. Okay. And forms what? Clouds. So if the surrounding air is having more relative humidity, what will happen? It will take long time for the white trail formed by condensation of the vapor to disappear. So if the relative humidity of the surrounding air is less, either the size of the white trail may be small or it may not even get formed. So this example, during winter season, most of you might have observed when aeroplane moves, it leaves a white trail behind it. Okay, what is the reason for this? Due to relative humidity, right? Now, I hope this topic is clear to all of you. Okay, so there is one something given in textbook. Try this. No need to go through that. That will not come for your paper, as I told you. Okay, try this and always remember, just put a cross over there, that no need to study that. Introduction to Scientist, no need to study. Just for your knowledge, you can read for your knowledge. Okay, so whatever is needed, that much only I'm explaining to you, students. So now even there are some examples, solved examples. In the third example is not there for you. First and second example, I will go through it. just have textbook in front of you. What all things are given? How? What is the solved example in page number 69? Students, let us have it once. How much heat energy is necessary to raise a temperature of 5 kg of water from 20 degrees Celsius to 100 degrees Celsius? Okay. Now this is given. So what you have to do? What is given? Mass is given 5 kg. C is given 1 kilocalorie per kilogram degree Celsius, and change in temperature, that is delta T, is given 120 to 100 degrees. So what you have to do? 100 minus 20. What is 100 minus 20? 80 degrees. Okay, so you have to write the delta T is equal to 80 degree Celsius. Now you have to use that formula, energy to be applied to water equal to energy gained by the water. Yes, so that means what? Mass of the water into specific heat of the water into change in temperature of the water. So that will become M into C into delta T. I already told you this formula. Okay, just substitute in the formula, you will get the answer as 400 kilocalorie. It's very easy. Just you have to substitute the values. Only see that delta T, some students will take 100 degrees Celsius. Don't do that. What you have to do? You have to subtract 100 minus 20. That is 80. So 80 into 5. Right? Now why 80 into 5? Because C is 1. Okay? C is always 1 kilocalorie per kilogram degree Celsius. Specific heat is 1. So directly you can multiply 5 into 80, that is 400 kilocalorie. Okay, you all can solve this in your classwork notebook, science classwork notebooks, all the solved examples, practice it. So at the end you can write heat energy necessary to raise the temperature of water equal to 400 kilocalories. Okay, next question is about a copper sphere of 100 gram mass is heated to raise its temperature to 100 degrees Celsius and is released in water of mass 195 grams and temperature 20 degrees Celsius in a copper calorimeter. If the mass of the calorimeter is 50 gram, what will be the maximum temperature of water? Okay, now here you have to use a formula of Q. Okay, that is heat lost by the copper ball is equal to heat gain, mass of the copper into specific heat of copper into decrease in temperature. Okay, this formula you have to use it. So Q will be equal to how much? Mass of the copper is given how much? 100, right? So mass of the copper is 100 grams. So you have to multiply 100 into 0.1. It is given in the question, what is the specific heat? Okay, it is in the question, it is not given, but you have to by heart it. What is the specific heat of copper? It is 0.1 calorie per gram degree Celsius. So you can go through that page number 68, where substances and the specific heat is given. Water 1, paraffin 0.54, kerosene 0.52, page number 68. I hope you all are having book with you. So there it is given. Iron is how much? 0.11. Copper is 0.095. Okay. So here 0.095. So they are taken it as 0.1. Okay. So specific heat of copper 0.1. Okay. Into 100 minus T. So in the infield substitute this way, what you will get? Heat gain. Now next you have to write heat gain by water. Heat gain by water is equal to mass of water into its specific heat, heat into increase in temperature. So that will be how much? Q is how much? 195. Q1 and Q2 you have to take. 195 into 1 into T minus 20. So heat gain by the calorimeter is equal to mass of the calorimeter into its specific heat into increase in temperature, right? So Q2 will be 50 into 0.1 into T minus 20. So in this way, you are getting Q1 and Q2. Once you get Q1 and Q2, what you have to do? You have to add it. Q is equal to Q1 plus Q2, right? So when you will add it, finally, you will get, after opening the bracket and solving it, you will get temperature T as 23.8 degrees Celsius, right? So when the school will reopen, we are going to solve these sums if possible. Okay. So the maximum temperature of water will be how much? 23.8 degrees Celsius. Correct. So these numerical sums, third one, no need to solve it because that is not there for you. Right. That has been cancelled from your portion. Okay. So And one more thing I want to tell you, mixing method and calorimeter. So measurement of specific heat and mix, that is called mixing method and calorimeter. Now here, the specific heat of an object can be measured by using mixing method. Okay. Now for this, what you have to use? You have to use the calorimeter. You learned about calorimeter, you remember in 9th standard, 8th standard, what is calorimeter? Okay. So if a hot solid object is put in water in a calorimeter, heat exchange between hot object and the water. Okay. And when the heat exchange between hot object and water, the calorimeter starts. Okay. This continues till the temperature of solid object, water and calorimeter becomes equal. So water, the temperature of water, temperature of calorimeter and temperature of the hot object, they should balance. They should remain equal till that it will continue. Right. So, and therefore what you can say, heat lost by the hot object is equal to heat gained by the water in calorimeter plus heat gained by the calorimeter. So what is the formula here? Heat lost by solid object is equal to heat gained by water in calorimeter plus heat gained by the calorimeter. Okay. So heat lost by the solid object, how you can write, is equal to mass of the solid object into its specific heat into decrease in its temperature. Okay. So heat gained by the water, Q1 will be mass of the water into its specific heat into increase in its temperature, and heat gained by the calorimeter Q2. Okay. That is equal to mass of the calorimeter into its specific heat into increase in its temperature. Okay. So heat lost by hot object will be equal to what? Heat gained by the calorimeter plus heat gained by water. So in short, what you can write, Q is equal to Q1 plus Q2. Right? Yes, Riya Tiwari, correct answer. Those putting in chat box, okay, they have written formula Q is equal to Q1 plus Q2, right? So use this equation, the specific heat of water and calorimeter are known. What you can find, the specific heat of solid object can be calculated. You can find the specific heat of solid object. So I hope this much is clear, everyone. So in this lecture, I explained you about, we started with what is heat. Okay, what is mean by heat energy? What is the difference between heat and temperature? Then we went to latent heat of vaporization, latent heat of fusion. Okay, after that we started with what? Next topic, that is regelation. Regelation, what is regelation? With a short activity. Then we continued with anomalous behavior of water. Okay, where you measured the anomalous behavior of water by using Hope's apparatus. Correct? Then we went to the next topic, that is dew point and humidity. What is the unit of heat? And finally, we covered what is specific heat capacity, right? How the heat is exchanged between hot object and cold object, and how to measure the specific heat by mixing method and using the calorimeter. And finally, we solved two sums, numerical sums of this chapter. So now it is the evaluation time, students. I hope everyone is ready to give the answer in the chat box, right? So let me ask you a few questions related to this topic, students.